morning. Good morning, everyone. Fascinating, wonderful stuff going on here at the Hyena Den. You're on a live sunrise safari. And the three cubs. That is incredible. All right, before I get completely overexcited, let me just explain what's going on here, then I'll give you the proper introductions. Two-week-old cubs. There they both are. That's the mother there, Inga, who sent us pictures trying to confirm that there were two. You've been right. I've been completely wrong. There are two-week-old cubs. There's a seven-week-old cub in there. There's the other two-week-old. That is the most dominant hyena that we know of, the adult on the top there. And inside is the seven-week-old. She has been playing around here until this very dominant hyena came along. Then, in the foreground here, we've got the six-month-old playing with a, I think, fully grown adult, maybe slightly sub-adult one, a young adult. This is just fantastic stuff. You are on a live safari here in the northeastern corner of South Africa, Kruger National Park, iconic national park of the world. And my name is James Hendry. On camera we have birthday boy Chepiso Sanchez Seleke. Give us your thumb there. It's just a birthday thumb. There we go, birthday thumb. And in the final control we've got Nikki and, oh, look at that sweet little thing sliding in there, and Louise. And Scott is out on the bushwalk with Andrew, and we'll hear from him a little bit later. This is just fantastic stuff. There's the seven-week-old. You can see much more spotty. Right, I'm just going to give you a little bit of a recap as to why I got completely beyond myself with excitement. We spotted these two-week-old cubs about, so they're probably almost 3 weeks old now. We spotted them about 2 weeks ago, and then they disappeared. It wasn't at this den. And then 2 days later, we spotted them, one of them here, or we thought it was only one here, with that very sort of, what we've described as the manky mum. She's got a big wedge out of her left ear, very little hair on her face. And I thought there was only one left. This is the first time we've seen them both come out of the den together. Now, that one that you can see in picture now is not one of the youngsters. That's a seven-week-old cub. You can see it's got spots down the front of the face and around the neck. And the other two, the three-week-old ones, don't have any spotting yet. I'm just watching this amazing play behavior going on here. And we had a picture from Inga. And she sent through a picture from one day and then a picture from the next day of two headshots of tiny little cubs. And she said, they're not the same cubs. And I kind of, I didn't dismiss it, but they didn't look the same. But we didn't see them together, and we felt like we should have been. And now today, for the first time, we've seen all three together. So they are all here. Try and get another view of the twins again. There's one of the twins coming out. You can see totally different color from the seven-week-old on the top. There they both are. Look at that. You just see the little ears of the two twins sticking up. Michael, you, much like the rest of us, say that this is a great start to the morning. Absolutely it is. You say, finally, some happy news here. Absolutely. Isn't it wonderful that they're both alive? There's wonderful playing going on here. It's so sweet. And Paul Rizzo, I agree. Maybe Pop, a good idea to try and put a camera at this den. Static camera, yeah, I think it would be worth investigating, certainly. Isn't this wonderful? It's the first time we've seen the seven-week-old come out and be sort of confiding, come down, play a bit while that dominant female has been here. Now, we were here earlier today, about 5 minutes before we came live, and that seven-week-old was down on the ground here playing with the others, and then that dominant female with the wedge out of her ear, the so-called manky mum, started to make a call, and immediately that seven-week-old disappeared back down the hole, and now she's sticking much closer to her mother. Her mother, who's actually a very beautiful hyena, is that one there looking at us, face covered in muck. And they were seen around the, apparently around the Djuma Dam camera, with their tracks all over the place, between there and here. So she's been drinking, possibly eating. Looks like it might be some blood on the top of her face. And Kevin, thank you very much for your update on the Djuma Dam cam. It was your update that's indicated to us that there were three hyenas at the Djuma Dam cam earlier on. She's just covered in mess. And thank you all for your birthday wishes to Tebs. He is the tender age of 27. So just a year younger than me. Now, what is interesting about the hyena social structure and the way the sort of cub mortality works is that if there are two females born, often one will kill the other. Here comes another little one. And if two males are born, they'll normally leave each other alone. And if a male and a female are born, especially to a higher ranking female, sometimes there can be a death and sometimes there isn't. Now, what's interesting here, I think, one second. So CYN, you want to know if I think they'll all survive. That's the dominant there. That's the matriarch at the top, I think. You can see the wedge out of her ear and all the cubs. And so CYN, I think that these two are going to survive if they've got this far. Normally, if they're going to engage in siblicide, which is, of course, the tradition of hyena cubs, if they're going to do that, it normally happens almost as they're born. So I think the fact that these two have got to 3 weeks old tells me that they're going to both survive, especially as they're born to such a high-ranking female. This is so special. I've never had a sighting like this of these hyenas, of any hyenas. A very valid question, of course, about the relationship between the twins and the seven-week-old. Lisa, you want to know if the seven-week-old would hurt the twins. No, I don't believe that she would, especially as she's a lower-ranking female or a lower-ranking cub, born to a lower-ranking female than the twins. You can already see her. She's much more reticent. She's much more shy since the arrival of this dominant female and her twins. Very sweet. Those are the two-week-olds. You can see there's no spotting on them at all. Sorry, three-week-old now. You can see everybody stops moving when that dominant female moves. There, she's just chased away the sub-adult and the six-month-old. Just see them playing in the background there. Now, initially, I thought that the six-month-old that was playing there was born to the matriarch, who was a large female with a big scar across her back. And this is fascinating stuff. And I don't know where she fits into the hierarchy with this manky mum. So we've got scarback, we've got manky mum, we've got pretty mum here. We'll give them those names for now. And what I think is interesting, I'm just going to turn this thing off. There they go. What I think is interesting here is that the six-month-old is quite comfortable, almost standing her ground to the monkey mum. She didn't run away there, but her playmate ran away. She's obviously a very low-ranking female, the playmate. And, yeah, what's interesting is that they're all just running around in front of us here. I'm trying to see where they are and what they're doing, but I can't really see what's going on. So I still think that 6-month-old was born to a high-ranking female. Now, whether she was, that scarback is more high-ranking, where the scarback is, I don't know. I haven't seen her for a long time. And whether she's higher-ranking than Manky Mum, I don't know. There we go. They come up to the top of the den. Now they're all back again. There's the low-ranking adult running past with the 6-month-old playing. On top, you've got Manky Mum and then Pretty Mum, who's unfortunately soiled her face so she doesn't look quite as pretty as she normally does, and all three cubs. Fascinating stuff going here. We're not going to move from here. Let's head across to Scott. He's got some interesting tracks to show you, and he's going to update you on what he's going to be doing this morning. We'll see you very shortly.
Hello everyone and welcome to the Bushwalk. My name is Scott and it's great to have you with me. Exciting stuff has happened. We've come across some female leopard tracks and you'll be able to notice there's a very prominent game trail or path here that this leopard's been using, quite similar to us using a road or a highway. And come and take a closer look. It's very difficult to see the tracks on this quite hard ground, and also in this overcast weather it's making it even more tricky. But I think there is a chance that Andrew might be able to show you this one track here. I'm not sure which leopard this is. She looks like she's got very, very small feet. You may see the back pad here and a few toes there. But again, very difficult in this overcast weather, because without any sunlight being cast from a low angle or a side angle, very difficult to make out the tracks. But we can see them and we are on a trail. We're quite close to our northwestern boundary, so that may make our lives a little bit tricky. She may cross out, but we're gonna keep on in this direction and hopefully have some luck shortly. We'll keep you posted, but for now, we're gonna send you back to the hyena den with James.
Everyone, look at that, right next to the car. You can see coming to wish Tebs a happy birthday. There they stand, just a few meters away. Not even a few meters, they're probably standing 3 feet. That tree that is now going to be chewed to pieces by this 6-month-old cub is, well, 3 feet from the front tire. This is just fantastic stuff. I don't even know where to look here. Now, a commonly asked query is about orphans, and I think it's our attachment to the fact that human beings are very good at looking after orphans, well, relatively good at looking after orphans. Most mammals are not. The hyenas are no exception, and Jose in Virginia, you want to know if that high-ranking female dies, what will happen to the cubs? They will die too. Hyenas do not cross suckle, so even though that pretty mother is lactating, she wouldn't adopt the cubs as far as we know. Well, that's what the theory says. Now, whether that would actually happen at this den, I don't know, and I suspect that spending extended periods here would reveal a whole lot of new behaviors. There, that 3-week-old cub is now either trying to greet or is trying to suckle from the pretty mum. And I think it's probably more greeting than it is trying to suckle. Hyenas greet each other by extensive smelling of each other's genitals, which is of course slightly disconcerting to try and explain to our younger viewers, but that's what happens. And I think that's what's going on here. I don't believe those 3-week-olds are trying to suckle from the pretty mum. They will now try and suckle from their own mother though. Thank you. now, what we've got three generations here. Well, we've got four. We've got the, we'll call the adults one generation, although they're definitely not, but you know, they become one generation once they become adults. We've got a slightly sub-adult one down below. We've got a six-month-old, a two-week-old, or some two three-week-olds, and one seven-week-old. And Sleepy One, you want to know at what stage of development they're going to start hunting with the rest of the clan. Interestingly, the hyena in the middle of your picture there is 7 months old and is about to start joining the hunt. About from 8 months, they will move a little bit with the clan, and then by a year, they will be fully operational with the clan. So that could be hunting, it could be scavenging. Listen to all the noises. Fellow called Ryan watching, who was laughing heartily at the youngsters falling into the hole. It is very funny, isn't it, Ryan? Hyenas can be very, very funny, just like small people, really. Lots of worry, of course, for the hyena that was killed, or not killed, was injured a little while back. And Michael, you're saying you're hoping to see a three-legged hyena wandering about soon. It's possible. If any animal is going to survive the injury that that hyena was subjected to, a hyena is the one animal that is probably capable of doing it out here. So in case any of you are wondering, there was a tremendous hyena battle the other day where a hyena had her foot sort of almost broken off and her left ear, I think, ripped clean off her head. We haven't seen her since the fight. We don't know if she's alive. I think it's unlikely, but as Michael says, maybe one day we're going to see a sort of three-legged hyena hopping about the place. Hyenas are tremendously resilient, so it's not impossible. Listen to these noises. Seven-week-old is very reticent to come out. Unbelievable. looking around seems to be some kind of threat. I've smelt something in the air. Look at this. Chasing that very submissive one around. So the pretty mum is definitely lower ranking than the big one, than the manky mum, but not so much that she's terrified. Not like you can see the other one running away. I'm just fascinated to know if that's that playmate, the sort of nursemaid, low-ranking adult that's calling now, and I don't know if it's male or female. Let's try and get a proper look. This is just astonishing. And Jennifer in Toronto, you say that the hyena noises are freaking out your cat. I have no doubt they're freaking me out. It is an incredible sound, everybody. And yesterday, I mean, we haven't quite had it this morning, but yesterday, one of these hyenas stuck her nose on the ground and she was making an incredibly loud noise. And they put their faces right to the ground and the sound sort of rockets along and then echoes through the leaves and travels down the drainage lines and the dry riverbeds here. It's the most incredible sound, and how it echoes is unbelievable. I don't know what the physics of it are, but the only other animal that I've heard echo through the bush like this is a lion roar, and they often roar close to the ground. Let's go quickly across to Scott and see what he has to tell you about the tracking expedition that he's on, and I'll stay right here and keep you posted.
Okay, so we are still on the trail of this female leopard. As you can see here, we've got a footprint in the sand. We are at the next road to the west of where we had that initial track, and sadly it is our western boundary. And she continued to cross the road. I've dropped a branch here, and this is to show other guides exactly where the track is when they come here. So the Sibambili and Arathusa guys who can traverse this area will see this branch and then know exactly where the tracks came. And interestingly, the leopard then came across to here where we have her last footprints in the sand here, heading across into Sibambili. Now I know there's a little water hole there, and maybe she's having a drink nearby, and who knows, maybe she'll cross back east into Djuma and Vuyatela. But for now, we're going to head out and see what else we can find and send you back to James. It sounds like some awesome stuff over at the hyena den, and we could even hear those hyenas calling from where we are here. Very jealous that you got to be right up close and personal with them when they were calling, because it's not something we see very often. Anyway, back to James, enjoy the den, and hopefully it won't be long before we find you something else.
I'm just moving a little bit closer. Tebs very smartly spotted that this other hyena coming in here, and I think, as he says, responding to the call. And looks like a different individual from the ones that we've had here before. Very chewed up ears and very full bellied. Obviously been on something to eat. That is, and where she fits in the hierarchy, I don't know. I'm saying she again because she's quite big. I think that other one who was being dominated earlier might be a young male. You can see a very obvious scar there on her, the side of her neck. There we go. Here we go, coming round now. James Taylor, you said it's the first time you've heard that noise live and you really enjoy the sound. It is an astonishing sound. And Bella, Isabella, you age just 4 years old, and why you are not in bed yet is, that's a mystery of you. Very late for a four-year-old. Isabella, well, I'm very happy you're on Game Drive with us this morning. That's that lower-ranking female, a new female who's just arrived here. Isabella, you want to know if it's scary? No, it's not scary. The first time you hear it, it's quite scary because it's a very loud noise. But now we know that they're not shouting at us, so it's not scary anymore. That's the female that's just arrived with its really chewed up ears. I'm just greeting, I think, the high-ranking females. Babies and greeting the high-ranking female. Might also be pregnant, you know. But I think we can very clearly say that the Manky mother is still the most dominant female that we have here. This one is definitely not very low ranking. I'd say higher ranking than the pretty mum. It's unbelievable. Now, anal pasting. You could see her sit down there and rub her anal gland on the ground so as a territorial mark. Could also, of course, be an earlier youngster from the Manky Mum. So, I mean, they could be related to each other. Becomes very difficult to tell once they're adults exactly how old they are. In fact, I mean, I wouldn't guess to within 5 years how old they are. I wonder if that isn't a relation, perhaps a much earlier sibling of these twins. There's marking with the anal gland there. And Mary, you're in Missouri, and an interesting question too, is it possible that the pretty mum is the daughter of the Manky mum? I would say no. And I'll tell you why. Because she is definitely subordinate. She doesn't. She moves every time the Manky mum sort of gets up and makes a noise. And also her cub won't come out and won't be confiding when the Manky mum is here. Now, look at that one there. Look, she's got very swollen teats. I think she's about to give birth. There she goes. We could have another generation of little babies here fairly soon. Made mention of the fact that the females are bigger than the males. The females weigh about 70 kilograms. If you multiply that by 2.2, you get to roughly 160 or 70 pounds or so. And Brian, you want to know what the difference is between the males and the females, exactly how different the size is. A male is probably only about 50 kilos, so 120 pounds, 110 pounds. So quite a lot smaller. This is just amazing stuff. Now, it's almost impossible to sex these cubs at this age. They will all look exactly the same in the genital region, and that's just because of the very odd arrangement that the hyenas have. So I would say that these are probably two little males, because they're both alive. They don't seem to be conflicted with each other. They're not fighting at all. So I'd say they're probably two little males. Look how sweet they are. Now, if that is the case, they will inherit their mother's status within the male hierarchy. So although they will be completely dominated by all the females in the clan, they will inherit very high status within the male hierarchy of the clan. Interestingly, though, that means that they probably will not mate unless they leave this clan and go off to another clan where they will be very low ranking. They will probably not mate. It's a fascinating facet of hyena sociality. And I would agree with you completely. You say the skanky mum, I think skanky is probably a little bit heavy. Let's just call her manky, shall we? One casting aspersions on her character, the other casting aspersions on her unquestionably fairly questionable looks. So the manky mum, you reckon, Diane, countermanded the request of the pretty one to bring the cub out the den. So the pretty mum came along, tried to call her 7-week-old out, and the manky mum seemed to countermand that request. I would agree totally. I think whatever this one says at the moment goes, and I can't see a more dominant hyena around here. I would very much like to see this one with the scar-backed female, the mother of the 6-month-old. I think that would be very telling indeed. Look how sweet they are. And then, Marcia, you're wondering which hyenas were making the noise. They've all been making a noise. The manky mum was making a noise. She was shouting into the hole. She actually stuck her head inside and started yelling. Then the pretty one was kind of making that groaning noise. And another one came up and was calling from the side. So they've all been making a noise. And then the little ones have been making those kind of chirruping sounds. So Jared, just again on hyena communication, you say they seem to be the only animals that talk to each other. No, Jared, they're not. Just about all the animals out here will talk to each other. It's just a question of how obvious it is that they are doing it. Elephants, for example, have a tremendously complicated communication system, but the sounds, most of the sounds that they make, our ears are unable to hear. Giraffe, probably similar. Not as complicated, I don't think, but they also do that. Wild dogs definitely communicate with each other in a pretty obvious fashion, but it's a lot more visual and olfactory than the kind of noise that these hyenas make. Now, of course, the noisier a species is, the more dominant it's likely to be. So hyenas worry about only one other animal. Well, I suppose other hyenas, but mainly lions. They don't worry about leopards. They don't worry about wild dogs. And they certainly don't worry about cheetah or any of the other predators. And so they can afford to make a big noise, because even if other animals hear about them, it's not a threat to them. Same with the lions. So you'll find animals that are more dominant have no worry about being sort of, have no worry or threat from other species, or be a lot more vocal than those that are. this is just wonderful stuff. Just give you an idea of the atmosphere around here at the moment. It started off clear. There is a wonderfully thick bank of clouds blowing over, and apparently there may be some thunderstorms later. Generally, these banks of clouds are a bit misleading because you think you're going to have a cool day, but by 10 o'clock, not even the thickest bank of clouds is able to withstand the awesome might of the African summer sun. And we're staring down the barrel, apparently, of a 35 degree day. Tomorrow, 39 or 103 degrees Fahrenheit. Let's see if that materializes. But any luck, these clouds will open up and give us a thunderstorm or two today. The land is parched. Hyenas, of course, have very cleverly built their den so that the shelf at the back of the den is away from any watermark. So even were, apparently I'm getting some communications from the final control, but I'm just not hearing them. Hang on a second. Let me just re-plug into another plug. Let's see if that works. I'm hearing the sultry tones of Nicky Austin now. That's better. So I was chatting a little bit about the shelf at the back of the den there and the safety that the young ones get from, you know, their own little nook inside the termite mound there. And Jose and Virginia, you want to know if lions came across here, would the rest of the clan come and protect the den? Nope, they wouldn't. It's the most brilliant arrangement, risk-free defense. These cubs would disappear down inside into areas that no lion would be able to get. The adults will just run away, and the den will be left, or would look like it's completely unoccupied, and the lions might sniff around, they might walk all over the place, but they wouldn't be able to get hold of the cubs, and that's how they defend themselves. Ooh, this is very exciting. Let's head across to Scott. He's got an endangered bird.
Well, you came across at the perfect moment as this ground hornbill popped into a little clearing. Look at that bright red head of its. I'm not sure if it's a male or a female. A male will have small little blue patches in and amongst that red gular patch. And there he goes, or she goes. It's interesting, we've only been seeing one individual in this general area, so not too sure what's going on. They usually move in small family flocks, but who knows, maybe this individual is out searching for some food to take back to a mate. I'm not too sure, but interesting that it is alone, and it is interesting that I personally have seen one hornbill in this area probably three or four times alone. And here we go. This is the individual we've just seen. Front cover of the book, which gives you an idea of how fancy this bird is. This is this little blue patch that I was talking about that indicates that this is a male. The female will lack that blue patch. Endangered birds, sadly, their nesting habits take very, very long, and they usually raise one chick about every 3 years. So slow going, that combined with the fact that their nest sites, holes in trees, cavities in trees, are being burnt down and chopped down, not here, but in surrounding areas. So they don't have a very easy job, these ground hornbills. And we're gonna continue, we're back in the vehicle. So a lot of you will be wondering what's going on. We've got the backpack back on the back of the vehicle, and we're hoping to move into an area where we can find some more tracks. So being versatile this morning with our plans, being able to drive and walk, and hopefully we're going to head out towards Buffalo's Hook Dam. Now I'm feeling lucky and hoping that we're going to find some tracks of wild dog. Okay. Well, it sounds like things are still going well at the hyena den. Very happy about that, and I'm going to send you back there with James right now.
So, not leaving here anytime soon, unless all these hyenas disappear. You can probably feel, maybe not feel, but you can hear a bit of wind blowing through here. And just one of the twins now feeding. The other one seems to have fallen inside, perhaps having a snooze. I will be very interested to see if they do both survive. I've said that I think they probably will, but it would be interesting to see. Maryland and California, yes, a good idea. Perhaps we need to try and name these hyenas so it's a bit easier to discuss them. I'm not a huge fan of naming animals, save for characteristics that they have, simply because I just feel it takes slightly away from the wildness. But I'm perfectly willing to accept that others like to do it. I'm happy to go with Manky Mum for this one. If you would like to come up with a better name, that's absolutely fine. I think we should go with maybe Pretty Mum for the other one that we know of. I wouldn't name these two twins yet unless we can get some very clear characteristics. I think as Inga posted that photograph, one of them has got a much more scarred face or much more sort of hairless face than the other. So maybe that's a method of describing them. And then we've got, of course, the six-month-old. She definitely can have a name. I'm not sure what to call her. She's quite fluffy. Maybe we can call her Fluffy or something like that. That's definitely not a very wild name, is it? It's not very terrifying for a hyena. And who else have we got? We've got the seven. Once they become adults, their ear shapes will change. Spots don't change, so I mean if we do see the same ones regularly, then it's possible to keep identifying them as individuals. But I think quite often, you know, we don't see if this den moves and we don't see the hyenas at a den again for a while. It becomes very difficult to then keep up with exactly who's who within the clan. So it's not quite as easy as it is with the lions, the leopards, who we see a little bit more regularly and tend to have a much more sort of, well, I mean, a lion pride is often together. A clan of hyenas is very seldom all together. Ooh. From a turkey to a pigeon. Let's go and see Scott.
Now, this is a sight we don't get to see very often. It's an African green pigeon. Oh, look at this. Little bit of a morning stretch. An incredibly pretty bird and very... And it just called. Oh, look at this. Looks like there's some courting going on. And will we see these birds make love? Who knows? It's possible. And that'll be a first for me. Never seen African green pigeons in the throes of passion. In Afrikaans, they are called a papegaai duif, which means a parrot dove, and very aptly named. Oh, there goes one. And on this relatively cool morning, it's not uncommon for these birds to sit out on dead trees like this. Oh, there it goes. And we typically see them more commonly in the summer months. So happy that we've got to see one now. And they're usually in the canopies of trees. They're fruit-eating pigeons the majority of the time, and usually quite secretive. So it's just in the early hours of the morning when they're perched up on dead trees like this, waiting for the sun to come up and warm them, that we get to see them. So the birding's going well, and ground hornbill. Now the papegaai duif, the parrot dove, and now back to the hyena den for you.
A back again, both twins now trying to get something to eat. And I was just trying to look at their faces. One of them's definitely got much less hair, that one there. Seems to have much less hair on its face than the other. Maybe we can call that one Baldy. I don't think that's going to go down well with the Twitterverse. It's quite interestingly, Tebs, yeah, just keep zoomed in on there. Have a look at the... It's either a penis or a pseudo-penis that this one has. And if it's pinched at the end, probably a male. And if it's straight, a female. So, that one's the baldy face. Let's just see if the other one looks any different. And she stops chewing off her mother's teat. Now, Janice in Wisconsin, please, it's all very confusing, so don't worry. Pretty Mum is not, is the mother of the seven-week-old. She's not pregnant again. There was another female that came through here with a very swollen belly and teats. So that wasn't Pretty Mum. She had wasn't that pretty. She had very chewed-up ears. So Janet, I think there is a third pregnant female. I don't think it's definitely not Pretty Mum. Pretty Mum is looking quite sleek, although she's a bit dirty at the moment. So at the moment, I mean, I know it's difficult to decide, you know, on who's who. At the moment, I think the easiest way of doing it is by looking at the ears. The Mankey Mum's got a great big wedge out of her left ear. You know, that pregnant female here with lots of little nicks out of her ears. We've got the Pretty Mum who's got pretty intact ears. Jana, you are making a very interesting question, and I think it's because you know a bit about wolf behavior, probably, and other canid behavior. In wolves, in wild dogs, in mongoose even, the alpha pair within the group, within the pack, are the only ones to breed. Sometimes a beta pair will breed, but normally not, normally only the alpha pair. It's why this female is known as a matriarch, not an alpha. And remember, hyenas are not related to dogs, well, only very, very distantly. And so although they look fairly similar, their social structure is completely distinct. So you want to know, Jana, basically, if this is the alpha female, the matriarch, will the others breed? Absolutely. All females in the clan can breed. They're not particularly good at looking after each other's youngsters, but all females within the clan can breed. And they don't always necessarily come to the same den. Lower-ranking females or newborns might be born in another den before they come to the kind of main nursery den, which is what this one is. And those twins were born at a different den from this one. Douglas in Arizona, you just sort of, as I was saying that, you asked the question, would the pregnant, currently pregnant female take her babies off to another den to give birth? I think it's quite possible. And then would she bring them back here when they're a little bit older, or once they're old enough to kind of come out of the den and suckle, so when they're 2 weeks or so old? Yes, I believe that she might. So often, apparently, females will give birth at a kind of less than central den, and then they'll bring them back to the main nursery den. In Virginia and Kentucky, you want to know if the hyenas give birth in the den or out in the bush and then bring the cubs to the den. At Virginia, neither really, not without being too facetious, they give birth at the den rather than in it or away from it. So she'll give birth probably almost into the hole, lying in a position like she is now. I think she'll give birth into the hole, and immediately, remember, those cubs are born with their eyes open and they've got teeth, and that allows them to immediately either kill their siblings and dig a shelf for themselves to lie on. Just fascinating stuff. Said these females, I mean, it's difficult to age a hyena, right? And they live to probably about 13 or 14 years if they're lucky. And sorry, I've got a game drive radio and ballistic in my ear, so I've missed where this last question's come from. But the question is, what age do they first give birth? And the question comes from Philadelphia. I'm getting closer to who it's from. Jan from Philadelphia. There we go. Dan from Philadelphia. Good grief, I'm just going to turn this game drive radio off. There we go. Dan from Philadelphia. What age do they first give birth? I think as soon as they're sexually mature, it's possible for them to give birth. So probably at about 2.5 years would be around about the time that they could conceive. Ooh, look at that. What a brilliant shot. Tebs spotted that. That is a little pygmy kingfisher. I can't even see where he's facing the camera. Tebs, I can't see where the thing is. Beautiful. Now, apparently this pygmy kingfisher has been seen here before and probably has a little nest around here, a nest in banks or in termite mounds. Could well be nesting around here. I actually can't see it from where I'm sitting. I can only see it from the screen. Ah, there it is. That's beautiful. Now, Judy H., as we approach Christmas time, you're saying, are they perhaps telling the pregnant one there's no room in the inn? No, I don't think so. I think they'll make a plan if they have to. I don't think that the other one will have to give birth in the stable. I think that she will most probably give birth at another den. I think that's most likely. Just to avoid any conflict that there could be from the youngsters that are already here. Look at that kingfisher, isn't that beautiful? That's brilliant, Tibbs. There's been a lot of conflict, of course, around here, and with that, well, there was a huge conflict a little while back with that female that was mauled by the rest of the clan. And Sarah, you're in Ohio. You want to know if this clan is in a state of upheaval at the moment. No, Sarah, I don't think so. I think that the behavior that we watched this morning is totally normal. It's just reaffirming social bonds. I don't think there's any any obvious signs that the clan is in a state of flux. The female here is completely comfortable with her dominance. She is completely comfortable with her new cubs. Obviously, tensions do rise when there are youngsters around because the females are defensive of their babies. I don't think there's any unusual, untoward kind of upheaval in the clan. Thank you, Sarah.
Courtney Noni. Oh, that's not one person. Courtney and Noni and Caleb. You're sort of asking about the males, where they are, what they do, how they spend their time. I think, Caleb, you said that the males just run around mating. Yeah, pretty much. That's what they do. They run around mating and eating. Sounds like a pretty good life, really. But no, the mating opportunities are few and far between because, you know, the females will only mate when they, you know, come into estrus and when they're ready to give birth, and then not again until they've raised their cubs. So probably about 2 years after they've raised their youngsters will they mate again. So, in fact, I think it's slightly less than that. I think hyenas do give birth relatively frequently compared with the rest of the carnivores, so that's quite interesting. But the males will forage on their own. You find that they are completely dominated by the females. They do have a hierarchy within the clan on their own, but all males are dominated by females. That's simply based on size. And so they will go and forage on their own. They'll often spend time maybe in a group of two or three, but most often on their own. And so when the day comes after they're foraging at night, they'll find a secluded spot, sleep for quite a lot of the time, and then as the night falls, they'll head out again and try and find things to eat. Lots of scavenging in this area. I think in an area like East Africa where there's more hunting that goes on amongst the clans, you'll find them doing probably a little bit more involved with clan life than they are here. That's not to say that they aren't part of the clan, though. Very territorial, and they will mark the territorial boundaries of the clan very carefully. And Barbara, your comment is completely accurate. It's absolutely right. The males don't hang around here because they're afraid of being beaten up. That's absolutely true. Because they will be beaten up. Isn't that lovely golden red color of the pygmy kingfisher at the back of the den there? Just spectacular. Look at him watching. It's almost as if he's doing the same thing that we are. And Ravi, I couldn't agree with you more. You say that hyenas are misunderstood, and the time that we've managed to spend here with them has given you a new impression of them, and that you've really enjoyed spending this time with them. Yes, I agree with you. And, you know, hyenas that look like this one don't really do the species a great deal of favor. And it was hyenas, I suppose, that looked like this that created the impressions for the Lion King, which then, of course, gave hyenas a bad rap throughout the world. Everyone thought that hyenas were great evil Nazis after the end of the Lion King. And they certainly are not. They are fascinating, beautiful, amazing creatures with a social structure that is totally different from any other mammal in the world. And of course one of the most Ted's just go look at the bird up the top there. It's a black-collared barbet, and I always pause when I say black-collared barbet because its most obvious feature is its bright red head. There it is. Isn't he sweet? They'll be nesting in tree holes and looking for tree holes to live in. And there might be some of you who haven't seen that here. He's not that common around here. His call goes, tupadli, 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 tupadli. It's not quite like that, of course, but that's how I remember it. That is the black-collared barbet, and you may just be able to see the red there. Wonderful. So, we just very nice the way the birds very kindly normally relieve themselves of the contents of their cloaca when they fly away, as we had with the Warburg's eagle yesterday evening. Now, question about how old hyenas can get. I would say, Desiree, this was from you, I'm pretty sure that they're able to live to about 12 or 13 years. I suspect in captivity, and they are possibly able to live up to 20, but I think out here you'll find me lucky if you're a hyena to get beyond sort of 12 years. Life is not easy. You've seen them fight each other. They fight with lions. They fight each other. They have tremendous conflict at food. And then that way, they are very similar to lions. Where there is no love lost amongst clan or pride members at food. I think those two little ones have gone to sleep on the move, as it were. We've seen the six-month-old here at the clan, at the den. The one I'm going to start referring to is Fluffy from now on, because well, we've been asked to name them, and it's actually, I agree, it's getting a little bit difficult saying the six-month-old, who's actually now 7 months old. So Fluffy is 7 months old, and when she's 8 months old, Orlando, she will start to move with the clan on the hunt, and probably only at about a year will she become fully independent of the den. Maybe 10 months. I'd say about 10 months she'll become fully independent of the den, but until then she'll be around here. Oh, Scott has another kind of avian masterpiece to show you. Let's head across there, and then we'll sit here for a little bit longer with these hyenas.
Well, Andrew's doing a great job staying with these white-crested helmet shrikes. There's a whole family flock of them. Some of them are babies, and we've seen them shaking their wings wildly in order to try and attract mom and dad, and also helpers from previous, not litters, but clutches rather, of these awesome birds. And those are the white-crested helmet shrikes. You've been seeing some awesome birds with James at the hyena den. And isn't it interesting how so many animals live in and around that den site? Well, we're going to continue on, and we're in the area of the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. We're slowly going to weave our way down there, and really looking forward to getting a little bit closer by. We may find some interesting stuff there, but before we even get there, we found something. Isn't this awesome? Perfectly round ball, and this is a round ball of dung that would have been rolled up by a dung beetle. Why it's been abandoned here above the surface of the ground, I'm not too sure. So that's an interesting kind of twist in the tail. Usually what the dung beetles will do is they'll roll this ball of dung up using either kind of elephant dung, buffalo dung, those are their favorites. This to me looks like buffalo dung because it's very fine. Elephant dung's got bigger chunks of bark and leaves and twigs within it. But then once they've rolled the ball of dung up, they'll roll it away using their back legs in reverse, chip, 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 often with the female latched on the side. Then they'll lay an egg within this and then bury it underground, leaving the youngster with a larder of dung to feed on as it hatches. This one is still solid. As you can see, we found it above the ground. We'll just leave it where we did find it and continue on though. An unsolved mystery of the African wilderness. Now, one thing that I haven't mentioned since we have been on foot is that there are some potential dangers, and in order to deter or prevent us from getting into any dangerous situations, there's a few little tools that I have. The main one is this ash bag, and this is just a sock full of old ash from the campfire, and it's a very good indicator of wind direction. We're in a bit of ground here, so I just want to get higher up for better picture. So we will be checking the wind as we go, and very useful to know what the wind direction is doing. We'll also be stopping and listening. It's very important just to make sure that you stop and listen, especially when you're moving through quite thick bush, which we will be shortly. And even though you may not be able to see something, you may well be able to hear it. Branches breaking, a soft rumbling growl from a leopard or a lion. And 9 times out of 10, animals will give you a warning. Not always. Sometimes you startle them and they don't even have time to warn you, and all they can do is come charging at you in their defense or running away. But the bottom line is, we know what we're doing. We're being very, very cautious, but there are risks involved with being on foot. So sometimes you'll hear me whispering. Sometimes you'll just see me stop all of a sudden. But don't be alarmed. It is all part of the thrill of walking on the African bush. Well, good news, it sounds like another very pretty bird that you've already been viewing is back at the den, and you're going to go and take a look at it right now.
So we're still at the hyena den, everybody, but we've come around the other side, and that is a kingfisher eating a lizard. It's got a lizard in its mouth. An enormous lizard for the size. Oh, look, and the two of them, and there's a, I think that's a juvenile. No, it's not. I think it's another adult. And you hear them calling. Let's watch what happens here. This is just fantastic. It's so beautiful. I'm sure they've got a little nest here somewhere. Look, they're sitting right above Fluffy the hyena. Oh, now they split up. So, Jenny M, we have come to the other side of the den. You wanted to know what was going on here. And what's going on is that Fluffy, the 7-month-old, is lying there. And she's being... That's a spider-hunting wasp flying above her head. Yeah, but the kingfishers are providing the bulk of the entertainment here. The one with the lizard is sitting right in front of us, still bobbing its head up and down. There he is. Oh, moving now. Thank you, Jennifer, for your slightly less than kind comment that if I ever have children, I should let the mother name them. That's fair enough. Look at them both. They're sitting there. Sharing their lizard now, I think. So the one is still holding the lizard, and I wonder if there's not some sort of courtship display here. I can hear a third one. Tibbs, do you think it's just the two of them? Mm-hmm. I think maybe just the two of them. So sweet. So just to reiterate, we have lots of kingfisher species here. Interestingly, few of them actually eat fish. So the non-fish eaters would be these pygmy kingfishers, the woodland kingfisher, the brown-hooded kingfisher. They are not fish eaters. The striped kingfisher also is not a fish eater. They're sharing the lizard now. Now, unlike with a raptor, a bird with that hooked bill for cutting meat up, birds like this have got to kind of swallow their prey whole. So there's often an elaborate process of almost sort of chewing it outside the body by crushing the bones with the beak, smashing it against branches, just so that it's a bit more easily digestible and doesn't get stuck in the throat. crew on YouTube who say these are amazing colors. They are. That kind of luminous iridescent orange of the beak to me is astounding. And where were these birds yesterday when I was having competition with Brent Leo Smith for the most colorful bird? It's very special to see them like this. We don't often see them sitting so beautifully confiding. And the bird in question from Wayne on YouTube. Wayne, you want to know about shrikes. Do we see them? Lots. You've just seen some helmet shrikes with Scott. We get white-crowned shrikes, red-backed shrikes, grey-headed bush shrikes, orange-breasted bush shrikes, magpie shrikes, the chagras, two species of chagra, which are shrikes. What other shrikes do they? Boo-boo shrikes. So lots and lots of different kinds of shrikes. And they are, of course, most obviously identified by the little tooth that they have on their beaks. Oh, look at this thing right in front of us here. Look at that. And Corkscrew, I think you must be in Australia, which is a fascinating wildlife place to be. Corkscrew, you say you get them. I'm assuming you mean kingfishers in Australia. Yes, you do, certainly, but not this color. Yeah, but we do tend to get slightly more colorful ones here. And of course, the most, I think, the largest example of a kingfisher that you have, there's the kookaburra. I think it's a very closely related bird to the kingfishers here. Don't know what a kookaburra is, everybody, give it a bit of a Google. It's quite an impressively sized kingfisher looking bird. This is just wonderful stuff. Oh, I can't believe it. Scott's found yet another nest. Let's go and have a look what it is.
Can you believe how awesome this is? There's an absolutely tiny newborn chick here. I think it's a water thickney, but I'm gonna get my little bird app out later and check this egg out carefully. As you can see, there's one egg and what incredibly well camouflaged chick. I'm not too sure how we got lucky enough to spot this, but we haven't seen the adults, so have no idea actually who are the parents of this chick. And or how old it is. What's interesting though is I cannot see any fragments of shell that it would have hatched out of. And quite often what happens is birds may remove shell because it'll be a very clear sign of the nest being here. So that unhatched egg is still cryptically camouflaged, blending in quite well. And isn't this awesome? You can just see it kind of shivering and shaking its tiny little eye that's hardly even open. It doesn't get better than this, and we have been monitoring a lot of birds that will nest on the ground like this, but haven't been successful in seeing any chicks yet. So this is awesome. This is a bit of a breakthrough for us here on Safari Live, and also a breakthrough for the birds, because it is difficult business for the birds to raise their young, and we've noticed that a lot of birds haven't even managed to get their eggs to hatch before they've been intercepted by other predators, snakes, monitor lizards. There's many, many different animals that will feed on eggs before they even get the chance to hatch. But we don't want to attract too much attention to this area, so we're going to continue our walk and see what else we can find here. But this has been absolutely incredible. And what a bonus. I will definitely be marking this point exactly to let the other guys know where it is, and we'll be able to try our best to monitor the situation and see if this other egg also doesn't hatch. Good stuff. Well, let's carry on. We are very close to the Buffalo's Hook waterhole, and you're going to be staying with me as you are. So let's see what else is happening. I did hear Brent call in a herd of elephants nearby. Also, come on, Andrew, maybe if you come around this way and then just show an aerial view, it'll be quite nice, of these eggs and of the baby, just from the bird's eye view as opposed from the ground. Look at that. Absolutely remarkable. And playing dead or thanatosis is this little tricks or chick's trick that it's using. By not moving, it's showing its best chance of not being seen. And actually, initially when I did spot this little nest, Andrew saw the egg but took a while to see the chick, and I specifically didn't say anything about the chick for quite some time, and it took him a moment or two to even realize that that baby was there. So testament to a tactic that works well, thanatosis, playing dead. Now what's happening with this other egg, I'm not too sure. Maybe it's simply not going to hatch. It's not uncommon for eggs to hatch at slightly different stages, and what may have happened is that second egg may have been laid a couple of days after that initial egg. To tell, but not uncommon for eggs to hatch at different stages. So it's not over yet for that other egg. That was too cool. Like I said, I'm gonna get out my bird app. Maybe I can, I don't think doing it now would make sense, so I'm gonna do it a little bit later, and we'll be able to check the different birds that hang out here. It's either a blacksmith lapwing, but I'm inclined to think that it's a water thickney that's responsible for that, and my little app does have pictures of the eggs, so that's going to be good. Okay, and I've just got an update from Brent saying that the elephants are sadly heading south away from the water, so we're not going to bump into the herd that he's out. He's on tracking team this morning trying to help find us animals, but there could be some other elephants in the area. Here's some very pretty flowers called the String of Stars, and one of the most common white flowering plants. Oh, look here. It looks like we've got a little bug. I'm not too sure what it is. Sorry, I knocked it down there. It looks like it could be one of the cotton stainers, one of the flower assassins. I'm not too sure. There's so many little different critters that grace us out here with their presence, especially at this time of the year. And doesn't this one have awesome little markings? It looks like it was busy just cleaning its antenna there, but one of its antenna are actually broken, it looks like. So it's going to have trouble sensing. It's difficult to see, it's moving so quickly, but one of its antennas did look to be broken. Anyway, the String of Stars, pretty little flowers. Okay. Now, Gex Gecko asks a good question regarding that bird's nest that we've just seen. And will the larger chick, the chick that's hatched first and grown a little bit more than the second egg, if it does hatch, will it outcompete or bully the younger chick? Quite possibly. I think we may have found another bird's nest up ahead here. I just saw a Cape turtle dove fly out of this tree, and we're going to go up and inspect it for a nest. And I've just seen a thickney flying back in the direction of where that nest was. So maybe that was the adult returning to that nest. As I was saying, Gex Gecko, I don't think that thickneys will commit siblicide like the birds of prey do. So a lot of the eagles and birds of prey will lay two eggs. One is basically just for insurance, and one will always hatch well before the other. If that first egg hatches, which it usually does before the other, it will outcompete the other one, possibly to a point of death. It may even kill it, force it out the nest. But with thickneys, it's not common for that to happen. There will be natural competition between the two of them, but it will not be to a point that they kill one another. Now, the Cape turtle dove flew out of this tree, and it's always worth checking to see if there isn't a nest in here. Okay, no sign of the nest in here. And another question through from Adrenaline Rush, who's watching on YouTube. Good to have you with us, Adrenaline Rush. And I'm not too sure how old that little chick is. I'm thinking though, it's probably within 48 hours of hatching. No more than 2 days old would be my guess. But then again, I've never seen a bird in a nest like that or seen one hatching. So the development and progress of birds like that in such hidden and secretive nests is quite difficult for me to analyze or understand, but what I am going to do is I am going to read up on it and try and work out exactly which bird was responsible for that nest. Oh, this is interesting. Little diker just ran off, and they usually don't hang around. It seems to be chewing on something. I can't see what it is. Have you got it there, Andrew?
Yeah, it's just chewing away.
Well done, Andrew. What could it be chewing on? It's not uncommon for diker to eat meat, actually. Let's hope it's not eating a baby bird. What could it be chewing on? Look quite big. And like I said, it's not uncommon for diker to actually feed on little bits of meat when they come across them. Bizarre fact, but it's true. And let's hope that it didn't find a little bird that we've just been looking at to feed on. Hello to Chris Rogue, who's suggesting that possibly that little bird that we've seen could be a nightjar. And nightjars certainly do nest on the ground, Chris Rogue, so a good starting point there. But judging by the shape of that bird, oh, Andrew just got snagged on a little bush there. He's got a long antenna sticking up from his backpack. So if any of you are joining the bushwalk for the first time, it's important to understand that he's free holding the camera and he's got absolutely no stabilizers or kind of assistance with that. And he's got a massive heavy backpack on with a long pole sticking out of it. So not easy to move around here. And that's why all of a sudden had to reverse there as he got snagged on a tree. So Chris Rogue, nightjar, I don't think so, but it could be. And judging by the shape of that bird, it seemed like one of the kind of thick knees or one of the lap wings with very distinctive shaped body. Very happy to hear that one of our youngest safari goers, Ryan, who's just 3 years old, is watching the safari. Hello, Ryan, and very happy to hear that you are with us. I hope you're having fun. And how cool is that little bird? Isn't it wonderful how here on Safari Life we welcome all ages, shapes, sizes, and it really does make for a well-rounded safari experience, having so many different ages, cultures, nationalities on safari with us. So I'm hoping there's going to be some animals lurking around here. It's quite a good area to find elephants. As you know, Brent did have some elephants in this area. And another great thing about Safari Live is that we've got all different kinds of people joining us. Some of them are new to the safari experience. People like Annie clearly are not new to the safari experience because they've just made a very good suggestion as to what that little diker could have been chewing on. And Annie suggests a bone. Very possible. And quite a few of the herbivores will chew on bones to get calcium and other minerals that they lack in their diets. But I didn't see any white in that kind of mouthful. It seemed like something dark that it was chewing on. So I don't think it was bone, but very good possibility. Okay, well, we are going to continue searching for anything. I'm going to get my bird app now and do a little bit of research on that nest and that chick. But you guys are going to have the joy of going back again to the hyena den where there's still some action unfolding.
Right, everybody, you've just come back in time for me to tell you that nothing is going on here at all. I'll just tell you what's happened since you've been gone. The two kingfishers sat here on these bushes for a while. I'm not sure what happened to their little lizard prey, but one of them flew straight into the hole there, into which Fluffy has just descended. And the nest is clearly inside the same hole as those hyena cubs are living. And Fluffy just went down straight in there right now. And that, I think, is going to be the end of the activity here at the hyena den. The manky mum, just see the end of her back sitting on the top of the termite mound there. She's standing guard, but otherwise all is very peaceful, all is very quiet here at the hyena den. In fact, while you were away, I have to admit that I did drop off very briefly, because everything is so wonderfully peaceful here on Sunday morning at the hyena den. Right, so from the incredible excitement that we had, we're going to turn around, head out of here, and see what other magnificence we can find. Sounds like the Bushwalk Dam was quite a hive of activity, and the nest-finding skills of Scott Dyson never cease to amaze me. Every time I think I'm catching up on the nest count, he proves me wrong by finding another two to my one. Normally three, actually. Right, here we go.